Oneida Community. The Oneida Community was a perfectionist religious communal society founded by John Humphrey Noyes in 1848 in Oneida, New York. The community believed that Jesus had already returned in AD 70, making it possible for them to bring about Jesus's millennial kingdom themselves, and be free of sin and perfect in this world, not just in heaven. The Oneida Community practiced communalism, complex marriage, male sexual continence, and mutual criticism. There were smaller Noyesian communities in Wallingford, Connecticut, Newark, New Jersey, Putney, and Cambridge, Vermont. The community's original 87 members grew to 172 by February 1850, 1208 by 1852, and 306 by 1878. The branches were closed in 1854 except for the Wallingford branch, which operated until devastated by a tornado in 1878. The Oneida community dissolved in 1881, and eventually became the giant silverware company Oneida Limited. Even though the community only reached a maximum population of about 300, it had a complex bureaucracy of 27 standing committees and 48 administrative sections. The manufacturing of silverware, the sole remaining industry, began in 1877, relatively late in the life of the community, and still exists. Secondary industries included the manufacture of leather travel bags, the weaving of palm frond hats, the construction of rustic garden furniture, game traps, and tourism. All community members were expected to work, each according to his or her abilities. Women tended to do many of the domestic duties. Although more skilled jobs tended to remain with an individual member, community members rotated through the more unskilled jobs, working in the house, the fields, or the various industries. As Oneida thrived, it began to hire outsiders to work in these positions as well. They were a major employer in the area, with approximately 200 employees by 1870. The Oneida community believed strongly in a system of free love known as complex marriage, where any member was free to have sex with any other who consented. Possessiveness and exclusive relationships were frowned upon. Unlike 20th-century social movements such as the sexual revolution of the 1960s, the Oneidans did not seek consequence-free sex for pleasure, but believed that, because the natural outcome of intercourse was pregnancy, raising children should be a communal responsibility. Women over the age of 40 were to act as sexual mentors to adolescent boys, as these relationships had minimal chance of conceiving. Furthermore, these women became religious role models for the young men. Likewise, older men often introduced young women to sex. Noyes often used his own judgment in determining the partnerships that would form, and would often encourage relationships between the non-devout and the devout in the community, in the hopes that the attitudes and behaviors of the devout would influence the non-devout. In 1993, the archives of the community were made available to scholars for the first time. Contained within the archives was the journal of Terza Miller, Noyes' niece, who wrote extensively about her romantic and sexual relations with other members of Oneida. Every member of the community was subject to criticism by committee or the community as a whole, during a general meeting. The goal was to eliminate undesirable character traits. Various contemporary sources contend that Noyes himself was the subject of criticism, although less often and of probably less severe criticism than the rest of the community. Charles Nordhoff said he had witnessed the criticism of a member referred to as Charles, writing the following account of the incident. To control reproduction within the Oneida community, a system of male continence or coitus reservatus was enacted. John Humphrey Noyes decided that sexual intercourse served two distinct purposes. In male continence, Noyes argues that the method simply proposed the subordination of the flesh to the spirit, teaching men to seek principally the elevated spiritual pleasures of sexual connection. The primary purpose of male continence was social satisfaction, to allow the sexes to communicate and express affection for one another. The second purpose was procreation. Of around 200 adults using male continence as birth control, there were 12 unplanned births within Oneida between 1848 and 1868. Indicating that it was a highly effective form of birth control. Young men were introduced to male continence by women who were postmenopause, and young women were introduced by experienced, older males. Noyes believed that ejaculation drained men's vitality and led to disease in pregnancy and childbirth, levied a heavy tax on the vitality of women. Noyes founded male continence to spare his wife, Harriet, from more difficult childbirths after 5 traumatizing births, of which 4 led to the death of the child. They favored this method of male continence over other methods of birth control because they found it to be natural, healthy, and favorable for the development of intimate relationships. Women found increased sexual satisfaction in the practice, and Oneida is regarded as highly unusual in the value they placed on women's sexual satisfaction. If a male failed, they faced public disapproval or private rejection. It is unclear whether the practice of male continence led to significant problems. Sociologist Lawrence Foster sees hints in noise letters indicating that masturbation and antisocial withdrawal from community life may have been issues. Oneida's practice of male continence did not lead to impotence. The community introduced a program of eugenics, then known as stirpiculture, in 1869. It was a selective breeding program designed to create more perfect children. Communitarians, who wished to be parents, would go before a committee to be matched based on their spiritual and moral qualities. 53 women and 38 men participated in this program, which necessitated the construction of a new wing of the Oneida Community Mansion House. The experiment yielded 58 children, 9 of whom were fathered by noise. Once children were weaned, they were raised communally in the children's wing, or south wing. Their parents were allowed to visit, but the children's department held jurisdiction over raising the offspring. If the department suspected a parent and child were bonding too closely, the community would enforce a period of separation because the group wanted to stop the affection between parents and children. The children's department had a male and female supervisor to look after children between ages 2 and 12. The supervisors made sure children followed through routine dressing, prayers, breakfast, work, school, lunch, work, playtime, supper, prayers, and study, which were adjusted according to age and ability. Oneida embodied one of the most radical and institutional efforts to change women's role and improve female status in 19th century America. Women gained some freedoms in the commune that they could not get on the outside. Some of these privileges included not having to care for their own children, as Oneida had a communal child care system, as well as freedom from unwanted pregnancies with Oneida's male continence practice. In addition, they were able to wear functional bloomer-style clothing and maintain short haircuts. Women were able to participate in practically all types of community work. While domestic duties remained a primarily female responsibility, women were free to explore positions in business and sales, or as artisans or craftsmen, and many did so, particularly in the late 1860s and early 1870s. Last, women had an active role in shaping commune policy, participating in the daily religious and business meetings. The complex marriage and free love systems practiced at Oneida further acknowledged female status. Through the complex marriage arrangement, women and men had equal freedom in sexual expression and commitment. Indeed, sexual practices at Oneida accepted female sexuality. A woman's right to satisfying sexual experiences was recognized, and women were encouraged to have orgasms. However, a woman's right of refusing a sexual overture was limited depending on the status of the man who made the advance. Ellen Whalen Smith, author of The Status and Self-Perception of Women in the Oneida Community, said that men and women had roughly equal statues in the community. She points out that while both sexes were ultimately subject to noise, vision and will, women did not suffer any undue oppression. The community experienced freedom from wider society. The previously mentioned unorthodox marital, sexual, and religious practices caused them to face some criticism. However, between the communities beginning in the 1850s until the 1870s, their interactions with wider society were mostly favorable. These are the best known instances of conflict and peace resolution. In 1870, a 19th century cultural critic, Dr. John B. Ellis, wrote a book against free love communities that noise inspired, including Individual Sovereigns, Berlin Heights Free Lovers, Spiritualists, Advocates of Woman Suffrage, or Friends of Free Divorce. He saw their joint goal to be ending marriage. Dr. Ellis described this as an attack on the prevailing moral order. Historian Gail Fisher mentions that Dr. Ellis also criticized Oneida women's clothing, as healthful uniforms did not rid Oneida women of their peculiar air of unhealthiness, brought on by sexual excess. Noyes responded to Ellis' criticism 4 years later in a pamphlet, Dixon and His Copyists, where he claimed that Dr. John B. Ellis is a pseudonym for a literary gentleman living in the upper part of the city. Noyes argued that AMS Press employed the writer after they read a Philadelphia paper article on the community and saw a chance to profit off sensationalist writing. In Anthony Wenderley's Oneida Utopia, he covers the 1848-1851 Hubbard affair as a moment where a legal conflict almost ended the group, who were only a mere association at the time. At the age of 21, Tryphena Hubbard learned about Noyes' ideas about marriage and sex through his manuscript Bible argument. She became the group's first local convert. Father Noadiah Hubbard disagreed with her conversion, and his enmity against the association was intense. It affected her introduction to community, which was noted during a criticism in 1850 that mentioned her insubordination to the church as well as excess egotism amounting to insanity. There was marriage before the community attempted perfectionism, and Tryphena's husband's supervision over her was increased along with the disciplinary norms of the day, physical punishment. In an October Journal entry, Double Hearsay alleged that Samuel Hutchins reported to Mr. Perry a conversation of Dexter Hubbard with lawyer Jenkins of Vernon, in which Hubbard said that Seymour had confessed to him that he whipped Tryphena with a rawhide every day for 3 weeks, that her back was in consequence as black as his pantaloons, and that one of her eyes was so badly injured that he was doubtful whether she would ever see out of it again. Despite the weakness of the testimony because of the double hearsay, the physical damage incited a strong reaction from the Hubbards. Shortly after, Oneida Community's district attorney Samuel Garvin indicted Seymour for battery and assault. There was disagreement among citizens in the district about how to understand this issue. Famous abolitionist and previous district attorney Timothy Jenkins saw this lawsuit as a political affair being adjudicated by citizens rather than the judicial branch. Their peace resolution campaign for the Hubbard affair was a party with strawberries with tremendous flavor, musciousness, and size. The community lasted until John Humphrey Noyes attempted to pass leadership to his son, Theodore Noyes. This move was unsuccessful because Theodore was an agnostic and lacked his father's talent for leadership. The move also divided the community, as communitarian John Tower attempted to wrest control for himself. Within the commune, there was a debate about when children should be initiated into sex, and by whom. There was also much debate about its practices as a whole. The founding members were aging or deceased, and many of the younger communitarians desired to enter into exclusive, traditional marriages. The capstone to all these pressures was the campaign by Professor John Mears of Hamilton College against the community. He called for a protest meeting against the Oneida community. It was attended by 47 clergymen. John Humphrey Noyes was informed by trust advisor Myron Kinsley that a warrant for his arrest on charges of statutory rape was imminent. Noyes fled the Oneida Community Mansion House and the country in the middle of a June night in 1879, never to return to the United States. Shortly afterward, he wrote to his followers from Niagara Falls, Ontario, recommending that the practice of complex marriage be abandoned. Complex marriage was abandoned in 1879 following external pressures, and the community soon broke apart, with some of the members reorganizing as a joint stock company. Marital partners normalized their status with the partners with whom they were cohabiting at the time of the reorganization. Over 70 community members entered into a traditional marriage in the following year. During the early 20th century, the new company, Oneida Community Limited, narrowed their focus to silverware. The animal trap business was sold in 1912, the silk business in 1916, and the canning discontinued as unprofitable in 1915. The joint stock corporation still exists and is a major producer of cutlery under the brand name Oneida Limited. In September 2004, Oneida Limited announced that it would cease all U.S. manufacturing operations in the beginning of 2005, ending a 124-year tradition. The company continues to design and market products that are manufactured overseas. The company has been selling off its manufacturing facilities. Most recently, the distribution center in Sherrill, New York was closed. Administrative offices remain in the Oneida area. The last original member of the community, Ella Florence Underwood, died on June 25, 1950 in Kenwood, New York near Oneida, New York. Many histories and first-person accounts of the Oneida community have been published since the commune dissolved itself. Among those are, The Oneida Community, An Autobiography, 1851-1876, and The Oneida Community, The Breakup, 1876-1881. Both by Constance Noyes Robertson, Desire and Duty at Oneida, Terza Miller's Intimate Memoir and Special Love/Special Sex, and Oneida Community Diary, both by Robert S. Fogarty, Without Sin by Spencer Claw, Oneida, From Free Love Utopia to the Well-Set Table by Ellen Whalen Smith, and biographical/autobiographic accounts by once members including Jesse Catherine Kinsley, Corinna Ackley Noyes, George Wallingford Noyes, and Therapone B. Noyes. An account of the Oneida community is found in Sarah Vowell's book Assassination Vacation. It discusses the community in general and the membership of Charles Guiteau, for more than 5 years, in the community. The perfectionist community in David Flusvetter's novel Pagan House is directly inspired by the Oneida community. Oneida community is given tribute at Twin Oaks, a contemporary intentional community of 100 members in Virginia. All Twin Oaks buildings are named after communities that are no longer actively functioning, and Oneida is the name of one of the residences. The Oneida Community Mansion House was listed as a National Historic Landmark in 1965, and the principal surviving material culture of the Oneida community consists of those landmarked buildings, object collections, and landscape. The five buildings of the Mansion House, separately designed by Erastus Hamilton, Lewis W. Leeds, and Theodore Skinner, comprise on a 33-acre site. This site has been continuously occupied since the community's establishment in 1848, and the existing mansion house has been occupied since 1862. Today, the Oneida Community Mansion House is a non-profit educational organization chartered by the state of New York and welcomes visitors throughout the year with guided tours, programs, and exhibits. It preserves, collects and interprets the intangible and material culture of the Oneida community and of related themes of the 19th and 20th centuries. The mansion house also houses residential apartments, overnight guest rooms, and meeting space. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.